India, perhaps the most advanced country in the world in terms of traditional conceptions of metaphysics, and the only country which has preserved one of the once numerous Indo-European pagan traditions. Around 3,800 years ago, the Aryans began entering the tropical Indian subcontinent, where they encountered the Harappan civilization, which had reached its most advanced stage some 800 years earlier. India was then full of Dravidian pagan peoples who were, it seems, more peaceful and prone to vegetarianism than their warlike Aryan visitors. To this day, high caste Indians owe about 20% of their DNA to the Aryans who came from the Russian steppes. In this film, I will look at Hinduism, older Dravidian cultures, and the influence and legacy of the British Empire in India, which brought my own family to live and die in this deeply spiritual land. From Dravidians to Aryans to the British, join me on a brief but personal journey into the history of India. Since 1399, the region around Mysore has historically been ruled by the Wodeyar dynasty. Except from 1760 to 1799, when an anti-British sultan seized control. When the British defeated him, the Wodeyars were restored to the kingdom, until India gained independence. The Wodeyars' tutelary deity was Chamunda, the fearsome goddess, a matriarch, and an attendant of the tiger-riding warrior goddess Durga. The Wodeyars set up images of her all over Mysore, but her greatest temple is the nearby Chamundeshwari temple on top of Chamundi Hills, which predates the Wodeyars, built in the 12th century. Chamunda gets her name from the two demons she slew, Chanda and Munda, each depicted at the top of the temple here. Legend states that the buffalo demon, Mahishasura, terrorized Mysore until Durga killed him. Thus, the statue of the evil demon stands outside Chamunda's temple. There is a neighboring temple to Shiva also. Nandi Bullcalf is the vehicle of Shiva, and his image is therefore placed near a Shiva shrine. Shiva himself is often depicted as a phallic symbol called a Shiva Lingam. Sometimes there are five Lingam to represent the five aspects of Shiva. Devotees burn coconuts outside the temple, while others give them to a guru inside who smashes them in exchange for some money. This is Vaideshvara Temple. The stone carvings are exquisite, and the overall ambience created by the architecture was one of peace and serenity. It is said that a vengeful queen of a neighboring kingdom cursed the Wodeyars after they took her jewels in 1612. Before killing herself, she said, "May Talakadu, their great city, become a barren land. Malangi turn into a whirlpool, and may Mysore kings never beget children." 400 years later, the Wodeyar dynasty never had any children for alternate generations. The government of India abolished their titles in 1971, and even today most of the 30 or so temples at Talakad are indeed buried beneath the sand. There are, however, five very well-preserved temples there that have been excavated. While other temples in the region were damaged by Muslims, the Mughals, the merciful sands have preserved those at Talakad from iconoclasts. The most impressive of the five temples at Talakad is Kriti Narayana Temple, which stands alone, uncrowded by neighbouring structures. Thank you. Most of the temples here are dedicated to Shiva, but this 12th century structure is dedicated to Lord Vishnu and contains a 9-foot idol of him. It's a popular destination for Hindu pilgrims. I'm sitting here in the Ooty Club in Snooty Ooty in Tamil Nadu, in the hills, in northern Tamil Nadu, that is, in South India. And all about me on the walls are animals that have been hunted, bears, sambur, ox, enormous rams, tigers and leopards. And there are paintings of fox hunts in Devon and in Berkshire, because this club was in use by the English in India as a kind of social area for hunters. And there was a fox hunt in the hills around this area. Presumably they were also hunting leopards and things and bears, hence the animals on the walls. And for a time, one of the huntsmasters was a relative of mine. My great-grandfather also used to visit here because obviously his sister and his cousin were members. And their mother, my great-great-grandmother, is recorded as being here. And both my great-grand-aunt and my great-great-grandmother are listed in the golf tournaments of this area. So they were involved in some women's golf tournament. So sport was a popular pastime. I went this morning for a safari looking for a tiger myself, but I didn't encounter any, unfortunately. And I went on another safari last night and there were no tigers. So that was in the tiger reserve near here. So it seems that the tiger populations aren't what they used to be. But I did spot a leopard briefly, which was nice. Because I have a relative here, I'm allowed to enter the club, which is a privilege because it's very exclusive. Ooty used to be a very small little hill station for the English, and since independence, it's become increasingly popular as a tourist destination for Indians, to the point that now it's become rather overcrowded and it isn't really so snooty anymore. Rather like the sports club that you can see I visited in my Ceylon documentary, this club here really preserves the charm of rural England. The architecture, the decor, the feeling. Unfortunately, it's rather faded, but it's still very charming and somewhat grand. I consider it a privilege to be here and I feel very English, even though I'm the only English person staying here at the moment. It's frequented by wealthy Indians mainly. The popular game of snooker was originally invented in Jabalpur in India by some British people in 1875. But it didn't really gain any popularity or notoriety until it was played here during the 1880s at the Ooty Club in this very room. Among the many British people who enjoyed the game here were Sir Neville Chamberlain. And he was one of the people who stood up for the Ooty Club in the 1930s, reassuring everyone when it was being questioned where snooker was actually invented, that it was in this club that it gained notoriety and that this should really be seen as the birthplace of modern game of snooker. I'm not much of a player myself, but I can see how it would be quite fun to have a game of snooker with a glass of brandy with some friends in a hill station in India like this.
Cecil Ralph Townsend Congreve, Esquire, Joint Master of the Hunt, 1936 to 1938.
So that's my second cousin, three times removed on the right, Cecil Congreve, and his wife at their wedding in India His wife's name was Esme Rowsell, and she's my great-grandaunt. Esme and Cecil didn't live here in Ooty. They lived about an hour away in a small planter's town called Coonoor. There are three main stages for Ooty's history. Originally, it was all evergreen forests full of elephants, as Congreve wrote in his book from the 40s, The Animal Ace. Now it's a bustling tourist centre and very busy. Formerly, it was a charming British hill station. Not very densely populated, but cultivated for tea and with beautiful English gardens, which still remain today. There is other evidence of British occupation besides the beautiful gardens, most notably the churches, which the British left everywhere they settled. When the British first arrived in the Nilgiri Hills, the area was primarily populated by remote tribes, such as the Toda people. And a few of these still survive among the growing population of the region. This is a traditional Toda temple up in the Nilgiri Hills near Ooty. The stones around it, these are from an old stone circle. We can't even tell how old they are, but they're still involved in the rituals that these people have. The primary worship of this religion is centered around buffaloes. There's a whole load of buffaloes just down there to my left. But they also worship the sun and the moon. On the front of the temple, you can see a buffalo head, the moon, and the sun. I'm going to interview a Toda man about their religion, and he'll explain it to you better himself. They're essentially a Dravidian people, indigenous Indians, no Indo-European influence at all. They have an almost matriarchal culture. They don't have proper marriage as we know it, in the patriarchal sense. Their wives are held in common. When a woman marries a man, she also marries all his brothers as well. And if they have any children, those children are considered to be the sons and daughters of the eldest son, even if they're not. And even if she has relations with someone who isn't one of his brothers, there isn't actually a word for infidelity in their language. So, yeah, it's very different to what most of the world's cultures have created. They're almost done for now, this tribe, the Toda tribe. There are other different Nilgiri tribe people practicing their indigenous religion, which is not Hinduism. But this one is just one. All around this development, year by year, Ooty becomes a more popular tourist destination, and the Toda people can make money, I suppose, from tourists, but their way of life is falling apart and there's very few of them left.
My village is Manjikal Mand, near the garden Mand. Mand. All first Nilgiris, Toda people here, this Mand.
Mand. That's the name of this place.
Place Melgrass.
Melgrass.
And the Tamil name is Garden Mand.
Garden
Mand.
Mand.
This father is living here first.
How old is the temple?
The temple, this grandfather is. I am 60, my name is Pete Rose, my name. My father name is Mutnas. His mother name is Herchigipuf. Uh-huh. Herchigipuf. This temple, this 52 years new temple.
A new one?
New temple.
Where's the old one?
This old one, I don't know. Father for us. Father is making.
Yeah.
This my man, this old man, my Peter Raj. Mm-hmm. 68 years.
And you worship the buffalo?
This my God.
Your God.
God, temple, my God. Sun, moon, buffalo.
Okay. Which is highest?
Right.
Sun, moon, buffalo?
Buffaloes.
Buffaloes highest?
Yes.
Uh-huh.
This my God is sun, moon, buffalo.
I see.
This temple, only buffalo milk. Mm-hmm. Buffalo milk.
You pour libations of buffalo milk?
Yes.
You pour the milk?
This buffalo milk taking inside.
For the God?
Yes.
Inside, what is inside?
Inside, this pot, two rooms, only pot, milk, and butter, and ghee. Mm-hmm. And another room is my people's. Only Toda man inside, allowed, not allowed, only another people's. Mm-hmm. This my village is monthly 2 years function. Mm-hmm. And January and May is making. Mm-hmm. This people, Toda people's, this only Nilgiri only people's. Mm-hmm. 178 Mandu. This village, Toda village, this only Toda village, Toda peoples only Nilgiris.
Mm-hmm. And what does the stone circles for? What are the stones?
The stone, this people, this father is father taking the marriage. Marriage take the stone. This boys. This he told on the marriage, no. This my man is this taking weight, the stone.
The stone symbolizes the marriage?
Yes.
Each one is one marriage?
Yes.
Ah.
This my buffaloes.
Beautiful.
Yes.
Uh-huh.
This one, the buffalo cattle.
Do you eat meat?
Meat?
Eat buffalo? Do you eat buffalo meat?
No. Only vegetarians. Only milk.
My next destination is Coonoor, which I shall reach by train, and this is a good opportunity for me to talk about the British role in the creation of India's railways.
The Indian railways, built by Britain. Here, shame be he who thinks evil of it. God and my right, the motto of the British Empire. The British are very proud of the contribution to India in the form of the railways. And my great-grandfather worked on the Bombay and Baroda Central Railways for many years throughout the 30s and 40s until he died. And on the year of his death, he received an OBE from the King for his service to the British Empire. As superintendent of the railways of India. So this train was made in 1930. This is the kind of train which my great-grandfather was working with. And this was in service until 2007. Shows that they were really well built. Whatever the negative consequences of the British Empire for its involvement with India, I think it's safe to say that the trains weren't one of them, and that their overall, they were a net benefit to India. People in India still depend on trains to get around a lot, and even trains that are no longer used and are out of action, like these old metal things, still attract tourists, mainly Indian, who admire the engineering, the construction, marvel of technology of his time. Still very impressive today. I'm proud that my family were involved in the railways of India, and I think my great-grandfather deserved his OBE. Well, this is an actual 19th century British railway cart. This carriage was made for the railways in India in the 19th century.
After a beautiful journey on the train from Ooty to Coonoor, I've now arrived at a hotel called Walwood Gardens. And this hotel was originally built by a Scotsman in the 19th century who named the estate Blair Attall. And that's because he's from the same family, the Blair who have the Blair Attall whiskey distillery in Scotland. The reason I've chosen to stay here is because this house was owned by and occupied by my family in the early 20th century, about 100 years ago. So my great-grandaunt, I know she lived here with her husband, Cecil Congreve, and they had a child here. I also know that other families stayed here, including my ancestor, Norman Rowsell, my great-great-grandfather. He actually died here. So I have family who were born in this house and family who died in this house. And knowing that he died in this house, I presume that a visit to the local church will reveal more about why he died, because I have no idea what killed him or where he's buried. I assume that he was visiting his daughter and that this was actually his daughter's house, because she is recorded as living here from, I think, around 1916, well into the 1920s, approaching the time of the Second World War. Whereas I don't have so many records of Norman Rowsell being here, although his wife is recorded as being here. So I assume that my great-great-grandmother, his wife, also lived here with my great-grandaunt, her daughter, while my great-great-grandfather Norman was working far away in Trichinopoly as a recruiter for Sri Lankan labor. His son-in-law, Cecil Ralph Congreve, lived here in this house, and this house has attached to it tea plantations even now, although those are now separately owned. There's a barbed wire fence just here between the plantations and the garden of the hotel. But originally this would have been a planter's house, and these would have been the estates that were managed by Cecil Congreve. I think it's interesting that I keep ending up finding stuff out about Norman Rowsell. I'm only here by chance. I came here on a work trip and ended up knowing that this work trip was so close to the place where my ancestor died, so I came here. And of all the ancestors it could be, it happens to be this one, Norman Rowsell, who I already made a film about in Sri Lanka. And I ended up making another film about him. But I think this is related to what I've mentioned before in the notions of names and the importance of names. Because in Hinduism, Namaka, Gotrika, the notion of the name you're given has an effect on you. My surname, Rowsell, is shared, of course, by all my ancestors. But ever since that Norman Rowsell ancestor, all of his descendants have had the hyphenated surname, Norman Rowsell, and me included. So I suppose he therefore holds a special place among my ancestors. And perhaps that's why I keep on being drawn to his story. And I think that that story needs to be told, and that that's what I'm going to do with this film, and that my visit to the church will reveal something that I have not yet found out about him. As soon as I arrived at All Saints Church, I was greeted by staff who were only too happy to show me the church records of people who had died in the last 100 years. Sure enough, straight away, when I open up the book, 1919, Norman Rowsell, died at the age of 63. To my surprise, he died of kidney disease. And it even listed the place of his burial, Tiger Hill Cemetery, not far away. This is the grave of my ancestor, my great-great-grandfather, Norman Rowsell, here in Coonoor. I didn't know he was even buried here, but I knew that he died at Blair Atoll, where I've been staying. And it even says here, died at Blair Atoll, Coonoor, Monday in Holy Week, April 14th, 1919. Sleep on now and take thy rest. The place of burial listed in the records I could find were in Bangalore, which is a good 8 hours drive, even with today's roads. But I knew that couldn't be right. And now I've been confirmed that he is really buried here. So finally I found the resting places in India of one of my ancestors, which I never thought I'd have the opportunity to do. But fate brought it about that it was found to me, and the help of the local church clerk has helped me to find him. So here I rest these flowers. Norman Rowsell, who died 99 years ago in India, I remember you. Well, ladies and gentlemen, I'm sunburned and tired, and I'm ready to go back to Europe. Thank you all for watching this little film and indulging me as I've given you some more insight into my own family history, while also, I hope, teaching you a little bit about India and the Indo-European roots of Hinduism. But if you think I've been self-indulgent, then please understand that my intention with this film was not to teach other people about my family history, nor merely to boast about the fact that some of my ancestors and relatives happened to be quite well-to-do back in the day. Rather, I'm trying to show another way of looking at life, one that is not really prevalent among modern people. I'm not just talking about Victorian English way of life. What I mean is a mindset in which our ancestors are still with us. A mindset where we live and they live through us. And we live in consciousness of those who came before. That is the Indo-European perspective. The dead leave this earth and they have no use for their memories and the ways of living. But we, the living, have great use of the memories of the dead and of the experiences of the dead. And so these linger with us. There is a continuity between the realm of the dead and the realm of the living. And that's what links us. So if you take anything in this little film about Britain and India, let it be to remember those who went before. Thanks for watching.